The skull comprises of skull cap and the base of skull. The bones of the cap are flat and they have intramembranous ossification, whereas bones of the base of skull are irregular and have got intracartilaginous ossification. Skull comprises 22 bones. 8 belong to the cranial cavity and 14 to the face. Between these 22 bones, there is only one pair of synovial or moving joint. The rest are immobile. These immobile joints are the sutures and primary cartilaginous. There are about 50 foramina in the skull for communication with the outside. Bones of the skull are forming the cranial cavity, parietal, temporal. These are paired. The unpaired bones of the cranial cavity are frontal, occipital, ethmoid, sphenoid, bones of the face. The paired bones are maxilla, lacrimal, nasal, zygomatic, palatine, and inferior nasal concha. The unpaired bones of the facial skeleton are the mandible, and the vomer. The anatomical position of skull. The lower margin of the orbit. Lower margin of the orbit and upper margin of external auditory meatus. A plane passing through lower margin of orbit and the upper margin of external auditory meatus is the Frankfurt spleen. And this is the anatomical position of skull. The sutures in the skull. The coronal suture is present between the frontal and two parietal bones. The sagittal suture situated between the two parietal bones. The lambdoid present between the occipital and parietal on each side. Then there is a small occipitomastoid suture and a small parietomastoid suture. Fracture of the skull bones or vertebra is serious because of injury to the underlying brain or spinal cord respectively. It is one's duty to wear the helmet to protect the precious non-regenerating nervous tissue. A brief description of the individual bones, the paired parietal bones. These are flat bones with four borders and four angles. Anteriorly, it articulates with the frontal bone. Medially, it articulates with the opposite parietal bone. Posteriorly, it articulates with the occipital bone at the lambdoid suture. And inferiorly, it articulates with the squamous temporal bone. At the anteroinferior angle of the parietal bone, there is an impression for the middle meningeal artery. A pair of parietal foramina are present on each side of the sagittal suture for the transmission of the emissary vein. Temporal bone. A pair of temporal bone forms the side of the temple. It consists of parts. Squamous part is the flat part. Mastoid part is a projection which is called the mastoid process. Tympanic part is anterior to the mastoid process, forming the boundary of external auditory meatus. Styloid process, posteromedial to the mastoid process, and an important petrous part. This petrous part is a very strong bone, and it lodges the middle ear and the internal ear. Frontal bone forms the forehead. It has an orbital surface. And has a notch for the cribriform plate of ethmoid bone. Yes. Occipital bone has a squamous part with a prominent external occipital protuberance and nuchal lines. The occipital bone happens to contain the largest foramen of the skull, which is the foramen magnum. It also has a condylar part and forms the atlanto-occipital joint. Ethmoid. Ethmoid is a small, thin bone with three pairs of ethmoidal air sinuses. It also has superior nasal concha and a middle nasal concha. Also forms the part of the wall of the nasal septum. Sphenoid. Sphenoid is a butterfly-like bone. It has a body with a shallow fossa, which is known as the hypophyseal fossa. Also, on each side has a lesser wing and a greater wing. The greater wing has number of foramina. The palatine bone. Two palatine bones. Each palatine bone has a horizontal process, which forms the posterior part of the hard palate, and a vertical plate vomer is a single bone which forms the septum of the nose. Inferior nasal concha is also a separate bone. The nasal bone. are one on each side with an internasal suture. The nasal bone is one of the commonest bones of the face to get fractured. Lacrimal is a delicate bone in the medial wall of the orbit. It usually gets broken and the lacrimal bone lodges the lacrimal sac, the maxilla. Maxilla bone forms the bone of the face. It contains the biggest air sinus, which is known as the maxillary air sinus. The maxillary sinusitis is the commonest, as its opening is not at the bottom but towards the upper wall. It has got processes. One is the frontal process, the alveolar process, which lodges 8 teeth, zygomatic process, which forms part of the zygomatic arch, and the palatine process, which forms the anterior 2/3 of the hard palate. It has got surfaces, anterior surface, which gives attachment to muscles of facial expression, medial surface, which shows the air sinus, posterior surface, and an orbital surface, which forms the floor of the orbit. This maxilla bone is related to branches of the maxillary nerve. Zygomatic. Zygomatic bone forms the prominence of the cheek. It has a frontal process, temporal process, maxillary process, and it shows a small zygomatic foramen. Vomer forms part of the nasal cavity and is a single bone. Mandible is again a single bone, and it is the largest bone of the face. It has a horseshoe shaped base or body and 2 rami. The rami have 2 processes each. The anterior one narrow is the coronoid process, and posterior one is the condylar process. The condylar process forms the important temporomandibular joint, at which movements of depression, elevation, and side-to-side movement, and protraction and retraction occurs. The various normas. The norma verticalis. Norma verticalis, one sees the coronal suture between the 2 parietal bones and the frontal bone, the sagittal suture between the 2 parietal bones, the lambdoid suture between the 2 parietals and the occipital bone. Vertex is the highest point on the sagittal suture. Brachma is the junction of coronal and sagittal sutures. Here lies the anterior fontanelle at birth. Norma occipitalis. The skull as seen from the back is known as norma occipitalis. It shows the lambdoid suture, occipitomastoid suture, and parietomastoid suture. The external occipital protuberance at the junction of head and neck is seen. It is also known as the inion. Extending laterally on each side are superior nuchal lines, which give attachment to sternocleidomastoid laterally, which is known as the chin turning muscle, and trapezius medially, which is known as the shrugging muscle. The view of the skull seen from the front is known as norma frontalis. It shows the frontal bone, the two nasal bones, internasal suture, frontonasal suture. Orbits are present below the frontal bone on each side of the nasal cavity. Nasion is a point at the root of nose at the junction of internasal and frontonasal sutures. Supraorbital margin is above the orbit. It reveals supraorbital foramen or notch at the junction of medial one-third and lateral two-thirds. Infraorbital margin formed by maxilla and zygomatic bones. Lateral orbital margin by processes of frontal and zygomatic bone. Medial margin by parts of frontal and maxilla bones. The external nose contains only two nasal bones, rest are all cartilages. Maxilla contributes greatly to face. It shows infraorbital foramen, incisive fossa and canine fossa. Maxilla has four processes. These have been mentioned. The zygomatic bone lies below and lateral to the orbit, forming the prominence of the cheek. Mandible forms the lower jaw. Head of mandible forms important mobile temporomandibular joint with the temporal bone. There is chin in the center. Union of two halves of mandible and mental foramen lies lateral to chin. Norma lateralis. This is the lateral view of the skull. It shows two temporal lines, superior and inferior. The superior line starts from the frontal bone, ascends on the parietal bone and fades away posteriorly. The inferior temporal line again starts from the frontal bone, runs across the parietal, turns downwards above mastoid process as supramastoid crest and continues as the posterior root of zygoma. The zygomatic arch is formed by zygomatic bone and squamous temporal bone. Posterior part of zygomatic arch is called zygoma. Zygoma is attached to squamous temporal by two roots. Anterior root passes anterior to the mandibular or articular fossa. The posterior root runs along lateral margin of mandibular fossa and above the external auditory meatus to get continuous with the supramastoid crest. Sometimes a small post-glenoid tubercle may be visible on the posterior margin of the mandibular fossa. The external auditory meatus. External auditory meatus is formed chiefly by the tympanic plate of temporal bone. Only a small part is formed by the squamous temporal bone. The suprameatal triangle is posterosuperior to the external auditory meatus. Its boundaries are supramastoid crest, posterosuperior margin of external auditory meatus, and a tangent to the posterior margin of the meatus. This triangle forms lateral wall of the mastoid antrum, the big ear cell in relation to posterior wall of middle ear. In case of severe infection and pus formation, the antrum is opened through the supramietal triangle. The mastoidosis. Mastoidosis is a nipple-like projection behind external auditory meatus. It is not seen at birth but appears at about 2 years. The styloidosis. Styloidosis is a needle-like process, 2 to 2.5 cm long, anteromedial to the mastoid process. Few muscles and ligaments are attached to the process. Temporal fossa lies on the lateral side of skull. Its upper limit is the superior temporal line. It communicates by a gap deep to the zygomatic bone with the infratemporal fossa. The temporalis muscle fills most of the temporal fossa. Infratemporal fossa. It lies between lateral pterygoid plate of the sphenoid and ramus of the mandible. The other three muscles of mastication and related structures lie here. Anterior to infratemporal fossa is the pterygopalatine fossa. Where the pterygopalatine ganglia and related structures are present. Norma basalis. The view of the skull from inferior or basal aspect is called norma basalis. It is divided into three regions, anterior part, middle part and posterior part. The anterior part of norma basalis. There is an alveolar arch containing sockets for 16 upper teeth. Anterior two-thirds of hard palate is formed by palatine process of maxilla. Posterior one-third is formed by horizontal process of palatine bone. A cruciform suture is seen between these adjacent bones. The foramina seen are incisive foramen in the midline anteriorly with the right and left incisive canals, greater palatine foramen on the posterolateral corner, 2 to 3 lesser palatine foramina behind greater palatine foramen. Posterior nasal spine is seen in midline posteriorly. On each side, a little anterior to posterior nasal spine is a palatine crest. The middle part of norma basalis. It comprises area from posterior border of hard palate to anterior margin of foramen magnum. Structures seen are posterior border of vomer, which separates the two posterior nasal openings. Behind is a broad bone formed by fusion of basi sphenoid and basi occipital. This is a primary cartilaginous joint and allows growth of bones. This part of the bone is marked by a pharyngeal tubercle in the median plane. The lateral area. Parts seen are pterygoid process and greater wing, both of the sphenoid bone, tympanic, squamous, and petrous parts of temporal bone. The pterygoid process is a single process at its attachment to the junction of body and greater wing of sphenoid. Inferiorly and posteriorly, it splits into a lateral pterygoid plate and a medial pterygoid plate. The two plates remain fused anteriorly and are separated from the maxilla by pterygomaxillary fissure. Medial pterygoid plate at upper end shows a scaphoid fossa. Lower end shows a pterygoid humerus. Lateral pterygoid plate gives origin to the pterygoid muscles from its medial and lateral surfaces. Greater wing of sphenoid lies lateral to pterygoid process. It articulates laterally with squamous temporal and medially with petrous temporal. At its posterior most point, between these articulations is a sharp small projection called spine of sphenoid. Spine of sphenoid is related to auriculotemporal nerve laterally and to caudal tympani nerve medially. In injury to the spine, both these nerves may get affected, leading to loss of salivation and partial loss of taste. The greater wing of sphenoid. The greater wing of sphenoid is pierced by foramen ovale. Main structure passing through this is the mandibular nerve. Posterior to that is the foramen spinosum, which gives passage to middle meningeal artery. Sulcus tubi is a groove between greater wing of sphenoid and petrous temporal bone. It lodges the cartilaginous part of auditory tube. The petrous temporal bone. Petrous temporal is a triangular bone. Its apex is medially placed. At its apex is the upper end of the carotid canal. The lower end of carotid canal lies on the inferior surface of petrous temporal. Thus, carotid canal runs medially and forwards within the rock-like petrous temporal bone. Foramen lacerum, about 1 cm long, its lower end is bounded by petrous temporal and basi occiput and basi sphenoid bone. Upper end of the carotid canal opens into the upper and posterior part of foramen lacerum. Tegment tympani. Tegment tympani is present inside the skull. It lies lateral to the arcuate eminence. Its edge is seen in the squamotympanic fissure. It divides the squamotympanic fissure into a posterior petrotympanic and an anterior petrosquamous fissure. Caudal tympani nerve leaves the skull through petrotympanic fissure. The tympanic plate. It lies between squamous and petrous parts of the temporal bone. Its anterior surface forms part of mandibular fossa, which forms the mobile joint, the temporomandibular joint. The posterior surface of tympanic plate forms most of the wall of bony external auditory meatus. The squamous part of temporal bone forms most of the mandibular fossa. It also forms articular tubercle. present at the junction of anterior and posterior roots of zygoma. Now the posterior part of norma basalis. The median area shows the largest foramen of the skull, the foramen magnum. The external occipital crest from the posterior margin of foramen magnum and the external occipital protuberance in the midline, also called the inion. The lateral area shows condylar part of occipital bone, which contains oval-shaped occipital condyles for articulation with the upper articular facet of atlas to form atlanto-occipital joints. Close to it is anterior condylar canal or hypoglossal canal giving exit to the 12th cranial nerve. Squamous part of occipital bone is marked by superior nuchal line and inferior nuchal line on each side of external occipital protuberance. The jugular foramen. The jugular foramen is large and elongated foramen at the posterior end of petro-occipital suture. It gives exit to 9th, 10th and 11th cranial nerves and beginning of internal jugular vein. In relation to jugular foramen are mastoid canaliculus, which lies in the lateral wall of the jugular foramen, and tympanic canaliculus, which lies at a junction of jugular foramen and the carotid canal. Most important is the stylomastoid foramen, which lies between the styloid process and the mastoid process. The stylomastoid foramen gives exit to the 7th or the facial nerve. Mastoid process is a large conical projection. It forms the lateral wall of the mastoid notch. The interior of skull. The interior of skull or inner table of skull is lined by its periosteum known as endocranium. The endocranium gets continuous with the periosteum through the various sutures and foramina. Thickness of cranial vault is variable. Parts covered by muscles, your temporal fossa, are thinner than those which are not covered by muscles. Inner surface of the skull cap. The inner table is thin and is easily injured. Markings of meningeal vessels are easily seen. Markings of cranial venous sinuses, arachnoid granulations, cerebral gyri are visible. Other structures seen are frontal crest anteriorly, superior sagittal sulcus lodging superior sagittal venous sinus, arachnoid granulations on each side of sagittal sulcus. Markings of meningeal vessels, especially anterior branch of middle meningeal artery. Internal surface of base of skull or cranial fossae.